So, what is our service level agreement? A service level agreement is a written agreement between an IT service provider and a customer. It's non what? It's non-legally binding. Document service targets agreed with the customer. Basically, we're outlining everything that we're promising to deliver. That's what we're promising to deliver. That's what a service level agreement does, is outlining in writing what we're promising to deliver. So, big deal. It describes the service, the targets. The reports that we're going to generate, and how often, right? The reporting cycle, how often are we going to report on performance, okay? We need to review this service level agreement on a regular basis to make sure that we that is still relevant to the objectives, that we're still aligning to the needs of the customer, that we're still aligning to the mission, vision, goals, and objectives of the organization. Okay? There are different types of service level agreements. One is service based, which only covers one service, only one service that we're providing, and it is implied to all customers of that service. Okay? So, AT&T, for example, providing internet to a home environment. That could be service base. Then there's customer base. We can write a service level agreement that is unique to the customer. Okay, we can have a service level agreement that this is what we provide to all customers, period. Or we can have that service base, right? Customer base is that we're based on the individual customer, we're going to customize the service level agreement. And out here, we're going to outline all of the services that we're going to provide to them, to that customer. Those are the services that they use, right? Then we have multi-level service level agreements, which is implemented with a layer structure to cover different needs, such as corporate, customer, and service layer, right? So, test question. Which of the following is a service level agreement framework? Well, service base. Describe service base. Well, it's a service level agreement that's based on the service and on the service and not any individual customer. Customer base is based on the customer. Multi-level is depends on the different needs of the customer, okay? So, service level manager has to decide which will be the most appropriate service level agreement to outline based on the need of, based on the nature of the relationship. Service level agreements must be clear and concise. Targets cannot be included if they cannot be measured. We need measurable targets, okay? Service level agreements will trigger the following activities, okay? Agree on service level requirements, service level agreements and underpinning agreements. Okay, we're gonna monitor, measure, and report. We're going to review these agreements. We're going to look at customer satisfaction, customer feedback, complaints, compliments, and so on and so forth, in order to ensure that we stay current, right? Based on our regular agenda of review for that specific service level agreement. So I think there's maybe one question based on this slide on the actual exam. So not too much of a big deal here, right? Very simple. I can have three types of service level agreements: customer base, service base, or multi-level. If I need my internal departments to have agreements, because I want to make sure that we measure our performance, right? I need to know where, which areas within the within the chain need improvement, and in order to do that, I need to be able to measure it. And so I may need to have internal departments within an organization. I may need to outline written agreements between them. So it might be that as a service level manager, I may need to go and talk to the manager of one department, talk to the manager of another department, get them together, figure out how we're gonna work together and outline operational level agreements and create measurable targets. Yes, question. What is an OLA? Hola. An agreement between an IT service provider and another part of the same organization. It supports the service provider's delivery of IT services to customers. It defines the goods and services to be provided, and it defines the responsibilities of both parties, right? Is this a legally binding document? It is not, right? But we can use this to measure performance, which then can potentially affect reviews, employee reviews, okay? Service level requirements. This is what I'm going to ask for from a customer so that I can attempt to understand exactly what their needs are before I outline a service level agreement. So what is an SLR? Service level requirements. This is the customer's requirements for an aspect of an IT server that describes the customer's service expectations, right? What is it that the customer wants? If I can have it in writing, then it would be a lot easier to understand, and at least I have a point of reference where I can go back later and say, okay, this is why we created a service level agreement based on this service level requirement. Okay. We're gonna collect that document from the customers, and we're gonna document it. The service level manager will document that early in the design process. I'm not gonna be trying to figure out what the customer needs, when I'm already designing the catalog, okay? And we're gonna figure that out before, right off the bat. Sometimes a service level requirement may not be required. Woo, man. Sometimes a service level requirement may not be required, right? Because if I as a service level manager understand already the needs of the customer, then I may be able to outline a service level agreement and then propose it to the customer, okay? Bypassing, therefore, the need for a service level requirement. So the service level requirements need to be based on what we can actually do as a service provider. Okay, if we cannot provide the service, I may not wanna give them that handshake just yet. All right, I'm not gonna put myself in a losing situation, okay? If I need to go out and make agreements with external companies, right? I don't just have service level agreements, I also have contracts. So I outline contracts with individuals or companies such as suppliers, right? I'm gonna have contracts with suppliers. If my supplier fails to deliver, then I may need to take legal action, right? We can take legal action. So hold on, Evelina. Okay, say that question again.
Yes. Okay, I'm reaching out to the supplier.
Okay.
And I need something from them. So now I'm the customer. And in this case, I'm guessing the request for quote or request for price that I sent, that's my service level requirements, right?
Okay, yeah, I agree to what you're saying, right? Yeah. I agree to what you're saying. But yeah, it's more of a partnership at this point, right? We are the customer at that point. Yeah, because we need the suppliers to supply in order to deliver the service. But that's why we don't have just one supplier, right? We have a number of suppliers at multiple levels, because we need contingency plans. I cannot rely on just one supplier. That's not a good idea. Yeah, that's too much of a single point of weakness or single point of failure. But I thought about what you just said a lot in the past. Yeah, so I'm in complete agreement with your statement. All right, so what is a SLAM chart? A SLAM chart is a color-coded. It's a color-coded chart, okay, that outlines or feeds into service review. It feeds information into the service review meetings, okay? This is where we can, normally we're gonna have, you know, specific colors like a red, amber, and green. These red, amber, and greens, by the way, this is test question, test material, like for real. What color codes do we use for a SLAM chart? We use red, amber, and green, right? Red, amber, and green. The red meaning that we missed the target for that service level agreement. So let's say that you're my customer and it's been a year already and we had agreed that we were going to perform a SLAM review or a service level agreement review on a yearly basis. And so here we are in August, right? From January to August, and so maybe every 8 months. Right? And so when I get together with you to review my customer, the service level agreement metrics, okay? I would bring a chart similar to this, and where I can say, okay, check it out. For target A, we did okay all the way until May, and then we went into the amber June and July, and then in August we're in the red. But here's the reason why, and here's the proposed solutions. I mean, I'm not just gonna come into a meeting to show a chart without having done my homework of what happened, what is the reason why it's in the orange or in the amber or in the red, okay? We had a hard time understanding target B, and so we were in the amber and red between January and March, but we've been in the green scenes. We made some adjustments, okay? And so on and so forth. And so amber stands for near miss, and green for target met, okay? So the reds are really what I'm trying to address here, the red ones. The ambers is more like, okay, we almost breached the service level agreement there, but we didn't, right? But over here, it's like things started failing because of this and because of that and because of that. So depending on the nature of the service that we're talking about and the objective, again, I wouldn't go into a service level agreement monitoring meeting or SLAM meeting without having done all my homework, talked to all my stakeholders. And maybe I already have written documentations. I may even bring some of them in so that they can explain, because I may not be a technical person who can explain, you know, technical concepts at that depth. And so I may need to bring in a manager, maybe a service desk manager or a applications manager to come in and explain, you know, what happened and how we are addressing the issue. So that we can continue to provide performance that's acceptable, so that to maintain the satisfaction of the customer. Okay, you know, it's not always gonna be in the green, right? That would be perfect, but things happen, right? Technology fails, and that's the beauty, right? That technology will fail, and people will fail sometimes too. You know, we're not perfect, despite popular beliefs. Or sometimes we lose employees, and so we need to get new people, right? That might have happened here. We lost an employee, and then, you know, we're kind of struggling with human resources here, okay? we're retraining basically folks, and so that's why we're in the red, and but we're trying to make some adjustments in order to change that. It may be that that's exactly what happened here, right? We were training some folks, and then so there was some ramp time here in order to go into the green, but once we figure out how to get the job done, then we were okay, we were in the green. So things happen, and that's what we need to address. Computers break down, so maybe from a product perspective, a computer broke down over here, you see that? And so, or a server crashed over here, and during these 2 months, we were pretty much fish out of water, trying to fix equipment and connectivity and so on and so forth. And then until we finally figure out how to get back on track, and then it took us about 2 months to get back into the green. You see, that depends on the nature of the business, but I have to have an explanation for why we are where we are, and I have to have a list of proposed pragmatic solutions. So fun stuff, huh? Yeah? In any case, for test purposes, you need to be able to elaborate on what a SLAM chart is and what colors we're using, okay? So just remember a street light, a traffic light. Okay? Those are the colors we're using, red, amber, and green. All right, so we're gonna hold this service level, service review on a regular basis, and so who's gonna attend? Well, the customer, obviously, right? The service level manager, maybe other individuals. The agenda includes service performance, changes to requirements, and then how are we doing the overall, right? The output of that is fed into the service improvement plan. Whatever we agree on based on our service review, that will feed into the continual service improvement or service improvement plan, the SIP. Okay, and it may be that we're looking at something like this also. It doesn't necessarily have to be a SLAM chart, but we're gonna be looking at performance. In this case, we're looking at number of service level agreements that were breached. Right, so 13.5% of the tickets were breached. Only 12% were completed or achieved. 12%, 34% were completed. 1.23 of these tickets were canceled, and only 1.84% of them are paused. Right, because what happens is if I get a ticket. The ticket is going to have a timer on it, right? Based on the service level agreement for that specific customer. But it could be that, if I'm in a call center and I get a call from a customer, well, the clock begins to run. But if I grab the ticket and I reach out to the customer because I'm trying to get more information, okay? But I don't. I'm unable to reach the customer because I called and they didn't answer. I left a message, so I emailed them. I'm going to document that I took those two actions, but those actions that I took allowed me the ability to pause the ticket because I can't allow the timer to continue to go on because I haven't talked to the customer yet. You see how that works? It could also be that, okay, a server went down. We need to order, a power supply, and the power supply is going to take 2 days to get there. So that time doesn't count for my ticket. You see how that works? So I can actually put a clause. There's a clause in there that allowed me the ability to also pause the ticket. And so because it's pending, delivery of a component, for example, or it's pending the response of the customer, and so we cannot allow that ticket to move on. I mean, there's many ways, right? Maybe somebody canceled and say, well, no, forget it, I don't need help anymore. And so in any case, we're examining, right, the performance. What is the service improvement plan or the SIP? It's a formal plan to implement improvements to a process for IT service. You have to, that's the whole purpose of slamming, is so that we can extract the areas where we need to improve, document them, and then come up with a service improvement plan, okay? activities of service level management, working with customers to agree service level requirements and service level agreements, measuring performance, producing service reports, working with CSI, continual service improvement, and managing SIPs for the implementation of service and improvements, right? We're trying to make ourselves better. And working with the MBR, business relationship management. Actually, that should be BRM, right? Yeah. That happens, you know, I'm a little bit dyslexic, and sometimes my, sometimes it kicks in when I'm putting things together, so I'll change it, I'll change it. All right, that's so much for service level management, right? There's a lot going on in there, and you will have a lot of questions about service level management and service level agreements, and what's the difference between service level agreement and an operational level agreement and a service level requirement. Okay, those are kind of the three things that you need to bounce around. As a service level manager, I need to have good relationship with the business relationships manager. And I also need to have a good relationship with my customers, right? So that I can understand what their needs are, and I have to have meetings scheduled so that I can stay engaged with what is going on. Okay, moving on to another topic. Availability. What is availability? It is the ability of an IT service or other configuration items to perform its agreed function when required. Remember the first day of class on Monday, our website was down. What happened to our availability there? Well, not available, right? There's your 0.9999%, right? Wasn't available. That's what's missing to make it 100%, right? That's why it's 99.999%, because it's still missing something to be 100%. Every once in a while, you will not have availability. It's kind of a given. Well, we could put things in place. We could have additional servers, you know, additional routers, a second internet connection. There's a lot of things that you could do to make sure that that service is available. We can increase the amount of random access memory. We can increase the storage capacity. We could increase the bandwidth by replacing network components or network media, such as, you know, replacing copper cable with fiber optic cable, okay, to make our network faster. Okay. Availability management ensures the level of service availability meets or exceeds the agreed targets that the customer needs in a cost-effective and timely manner. We're not going to promise 100% availability. Okay, we're trying to shoot for 99.999%. There are three components to availability. Whoa, this is where it gets a little. Three components to availability. One is reliability, the second one is maintainability, and the third one is serviceability. In order to have proper availability, we need to have reliability. And what is reliability? It's a measure of how long an IT service or other configuration item can perform its agreed function without interruption. We refer to this as mean time between failures. Mean time between failures. What is mean time between failures? What's that?
How long is this down for? Time between failures is excessive. Your performance.
Say again?
Right.
What'd you say? I can, you know, when I think of mean time between failures, I'm thinking of, that reminds me of is when you go buy a light bulbs, and different light bulbs will say 10,000 hours, right? Another one will say 15,000 hours of life expectancy. What is the life expectancy of the device, right? When you buy a hard drive, for example, how long are you expecting that hard drive to last? When you replace your brakes in your vehicle, how long are those brakes going to last? What is the mean time between failures? Okay, well, it depends on how much you drive, right? And also your driving style. But that's what mean time between failures. So it's how long a component will last before it fails. That's mean time between failures. Okay, so if I could replace my light bulbs with light bulbs that will, instead of, you know, promising 10,000 hours, will last 15,000 hours. So I'm increasing my mean time between failure, right? So mean time between failures, the larger the number, the better. Mm-hmm. You see how that works? Yes, sir. Oh, I'm not there yet. Hold on. I'm explaining one concept first. You're trying to push me around. You guys see that? All right. So that is reliability. What reliability has to do with mean time between failures. How effective is a component or a service? That's we're trying to increase our mean time between failures. We don't want our service to fail. Okay. So remember when we were talking about how we can, maybe you're given a target, and the target is customer satisfaction. Let's say my boss comes to me and say, hey, I'm concerned about customer satisfaction. We just did some surveys, and you know, we're at 4.3 out of 5, and we should be really closer to 5. Okay, well, how can I increase customer satisfaction? One of the ways in which I can increase customer satisfaction is by increasing mean time between failures, because everything is fine and nobody complains while something is working. The moment it fails, that phone is ringing off the hook. Now you exist. You don't exist, nobody remembers who you are as long as it works. But once it fails, your name pops up. And then maintainability is a measure of how quickly and effectively an IT service or other configuration item can be restored to a normal working order after failure. We refer to this as mean time to restore service. That is the amount of time that it takes you, IT service department, to restore the service after the service has failed. Hey, didn't somebody just say that the electricity went out yesterday up in the East Bay or Oakland or something? Yeah, you see that? So what happens? Most people will get on the phone, call PG&E, right, to try to figure out when my light coming back. We got to say, I need to watch my Bachelorette show. Just came out. You're trying to find out how much time before they restore the service. And so right now they have a system in place that if you call AT&T, see, that's why they need to pay me money, because PG&E, right? You call PG&E and they have a automated system that will tell you based on your zip code whether there's an outage and how long was the estimated time to restore the service, okay? And so we're trying to minimize. So the smaller the number, the better. The smaller the number, the better here for mean time to restore service. The larger the number for mean time between failure, the better, right? I want the larger the amount of days and the amount of months, the better. And so this is where they might give you some tricky questions, right? Where they might say, okay, you know, they might give you a scenario. They might say, okay, well, you have this customer and you're providing service and the server went down. How do you refer to the amount of time that it takes for the service to be restored? And so you're gonna have to choose between MTRF, MTRS or MTBF or a list of other options. Okay, and so the scenario-based situation, this is where they're gonna try to get you. This is the mean time to restore service. And then we call that maintainability. Can we, instead of having our service shut down for 6 hours. I only want them shut down for 2 hours because I'm trying to manipulate my customer satisfaction, okay? Serviceability is the ability of a third-party supplier to meet terms of its contract. This contract includes agreed levels of reliability, availability, and maintainability for a configuration item. So these two right here are the two that you need to worry about. I think there's another one. Yes.
So the reason why I asked, I didn't mean to jump ahead of you right there. I was just looking back because I remember talking about it in lesson two.
Right.
So I just wanted to make sure that in the meantime there was four services that meant something different, or we're just getting it prepped for this.
Right. And what was the acronym for the other one? Meantime to restore service. There's another terminology that goes with this, but it's not part of ITIL. Okay, that's project management. Also, sometimes, sometimes.
Is
that CMDB?
CMDB?
CMDB is something else. No, CMDB is, but in any case, these are the two that you need to worry about. What is MTBF? Mean time between failures. Okay, that's how long a device or a component will operate without failing. Okay, and mean time to restore service is how long is it going to take me to restore the service? If there's a natural disaster, okay, and the service goes down, I'm going to have contingency plan that will reduce the amount of time or continuity, right? I'm gonna have to have a continuity. Continuity and availability are kind of together, right? Because if we're talking about in the case of natural disaster, then it may take longer, right? Our mean time to restore service in the case of natural disaster may be longer depending on our contingency plan, mm-hmm. or continuity plan, based on our continuity plan. Yes. That's serviceability, right? Because if we're downtime to perform maintenance is maintainability. Yeah. So that's mean time to restore service. Right.
So it's not like a mistake or accident happened somewhere. It was planned better to implement like the change or something else like that in the day. So sometimes you go on the website and it says they're currently maintaining the website, so check again in like 5 minutes.
Right, that's maintainability as well, right? Because we're providing maintenance. Mm-hmm. It's not necessarily a failure, but it's still downtime. It's downtime, okay?
So that won't be service.
That won't be what?
Serviceability.
Serviceability? Okay, see, this is where even I'm getting confused. Okay, you guys are killing me now. Okay, reliability is meantime, is how reliable is the component, right? It's like when you're looking to buy a vehicle, you're looking to buy a reliable vehicle, right? What does that mean? That means that you don't want a vehicle that will break down, okay? You just bought it and already broke down. That's not cool, not reliable. Maintainability is how quickly can we bring the component or the device back into service after failure or downtime or planned downtime. Uh-huh. Because serviceability has to do with third party, the ability of a third party to provide or to meet the terms of its contract. Okay, and this is where we need to slow down here for a minute because we need to have these terminologies clear. Okay, when we're talking about we're providing maintenance, so we need some downtime, we refer to that as mean time to restore service. If the device fails, right, this is, that's not necessarily planned. But this is why we're trying to minimize the mean time between service to restore services by understanding the mean time between failures. Because if I know that a hard drive's life expectancy is 10 years, for example, right? I'm not gonna wait 10 years to replace it, but rather I'm gonna replace them every 6 or 7 years. So and then I'm gonna donate those components to the community, right, for reuse. So we have a plan of reducing the mean time between failures by upgrading or replacing before it fails. Not gonna wait until it fails. That's right. Okay, so make sure availability targets. Language is kind of mixed over there. All right, so let's look at it from a different perspective. Okay, why is availability important? Because you know the customer needs access to at least vital business functions. Remember vital business functions? Okay, what is service availability involves all aspects of service availability and unavailability and the impact of component availability, okay? So availability defines that there are some components of our service that are really vital and we need to make sure that those are available even if other functions that are not necessary and vital are not working. So an example is the ATM machine, okay? If you go to an ATM machine and the ATM machine's printer is down, well, that doesn't mean that the ATM machine doesn't operate, right? You could probably still fetch some dollars out of the ATM machine. Okay, so how much availability are we providing? Well, we're not gonna shut down the entire machine only because the printer is down. We're gonna allow the machine to continue to operate and just give a warning to the user that, giving them the option if they want a receipt or not. If they want a receipt, we cannot provide a receipt right now. And so therefore, if you really require a receipt, you cannot continue with the transaction, okay? But in case of, at the very least, we're trying to invest enough capital or enough resources to maintain our vital business functions. If our system goes down, at least let's worry first about our vital business functions, and then we'll worry about the stuff that we don't necessarily need. Okay, that's why sometimes one of the things I've seen my bank do, U.S. Bank. It's not my bank, but it's the bank where I put my money in. But what they do is sometimes when they're doing maintenance. Sometimes they used to shut the whole website down, like completely not available. But what I've noticed over the last maybe year or so is that when they are doing maintenance, they've increased their availability because when they're doing maintenance, you can still log in, but you don't have access to everything. Right. You only have access to certain areas. And if you want to do a transaction from one account to another, it won't let you because that particular function is not working, but at least you can see your balance and you can see your transactions, okay? So we're giving you vital business functions while we're providing maintenance. You see how that works? In any case, dispensing cash is a vital business function in this example, but statements are not necessarily essential. Key concepts of availability. Whoa, this is where ARMS comes into place. Did I get the right amount of S's in there this time? Oh no, I'm missing an R. I knew I was missing something there. Let me try to fix that. Okay, ARMS. Key concepts, okay, of availability, vital business functions. We have high availability minimizes or masks the effects of IT component failure. What are we doing when we are allowing the ATM machine to dispense cash but not provide a receipt because it's not functioning? We are masking the negative effects okay, of the fact that the machine is failing but it's still functional to a certain extent. So you got your in any case, high availability means that we're going to focus our energy on vital business functions, and we're going to attempt to mask the failures. Okay. Fault tolerance. What is fault tolerance? The ability to continue to function after failure. You have to memorize these terms. What is high availability is the ability to continue to operate even though there's failure in the system. And we're going to mask the failure so that the customer, the impact to the customer is not as negative as possible, okay? Fault tolerance has to do with the ability of this service to operate in or to be back, to continue to operate in the case of failure, ability to continue to function after failure. How do we address that issue? In the case of computer servers, for example, the way we address fault tolerance is that we know that hard drives will fail, correct?
Correct.
Hard drives will fail. And so what we do is that instead of having just one hard drive, I'm gonna do a hard drive like this. Instead of having one single hard drive in a computer, we have two hard drives. This is what we call a RAID configuration. What does RAID stand for? RAID stands for redundant array of independent disks, or redundant array of inexpensive disks. It's the same thing. Two different terms mean the same thing. Basically, what we're doing is we're trying to create redundancy. And by creating redundancy, we are addressing our fault tolerance. It's the ability of this computer to continue to operate even if it fails. So we're going to configure this computer server so that if we write information on one hard drive, for example, okay, we're going to make an exact copy on a different hard drive, so that if the first hard drive fails, we have an exact copy of the data on the second hard drive, right? This is called fault tolerant. Even if the one hard drive is experiencing failure, this configuration will allow for tolerance to failure. Okay, we will allow that one to fail, but we can continue to operate here, and then we can notify somebody that this one of the hard drives is down and that it needs replacement, and then we can schedule a replacement, you know, maintenance schedule. So this type of configuration where we have two hard drives, for example, in a computer server or a computer, in a redundant array of independent disk configuration, it's called mirroring. Mirroring. This is how Google, for example, is so effective, because what happens is whatever is being written here in Santa Clara in their computer servers, it is also being written or copied or imaged or mirrored in another computer server in another part of the world. So if North Korea finally decides to or figures out how to get some missiles down to the East Coast, to the West Coast, and puts us out of business, I'm not trying to scare anybody, by the way, I'm just trying to be realistic, okay? Then we have copies of all the information in other parts of the world. All right. Sort of a gigantic worldwide mesh topology.
What?
It's sort of like a gigantic worldwide mesh topology in which we have multiple locations. Why do we do that? Why do we do that? Who invented this? You know, the U.S. government invented a lot of these concepts back in the day because, you know, like what happened in Vietnam. Vietnam, you know, we might have lost the war, but we sure learned a lot about how to get things done right, you know, because, like, for example, in Vietnam, we had a lot of loss of human lives because we had a centralized location. A centralized location that was the headquarters. If the Vietnamese took out our headquarters, everybody was left on their own. Everybody was left on their own and they didn't know where they were or whether the fire that was coming from over there was friendly fire or enemy fire because there was lack of communication. But by decentralizing the headquarters, then we are then we can continue to operate without problems, without too many problems, even if they take one of our bases down. So that's why that's how we came up with the Ethernet, the implementation of the Ethernet, and eventually the Internet, okay? But because what is the Internet? What happens? How come you always, if you go to yahoo.com, the problem is rarely going to be yahoo.com. It's going to be your connection or your computer because the way they are set up right now is that even if they, you know, take down one part of the network, it reverts to another area so that to address the fault tolerance. You know, back in the day, some of you probably remember in the early 90s. You all remember early 90s? He's like, man, I was 2 years old. Yeah, you know, back in the dial-up days. Oh man, that was, man, we felt like we were like Star Trek, you know, like Star Wars, you know, when it would take 5 minutes to log into the internet, right? But in any case, on a regular basis, we would hear on the news that Yahoo was taken down, you know, for like 3 days, not available, right? MSN was taken down by attackers and there was no fault tolerance, okay? A small attack would bring down half of the internet. And so eventually we've learned and we've built fault tolerance into the system. And so so we have ways to mitigate that, right? How would a company mitigate fault tolerance for connectivity, for example? Well, I'm not just gonna have one internet connection. I'm also gonna have, I may have two or three internet connections. Okay, so that if Comcast service goes down, AT&T is still operational. If AT&T Comcast goes down, I have a T1 connection through satellite. So I can continue to provide service. That could be part of my fault tolerance plan. If I'm responsible for availability, I'm the availability manager. To mitigate means that there's been a problem already and we're mitigating the problem. We're mitigating the problem. So right here what we're trying to do is minimize the impact of failure. Okay? So that it's to the customer is similar. They don't know what's going on. For all we know, 10 servers could have gone down last night on Google and you don't even know, right? Because that's on their end. They've done everything in their power so that for us, it's like, ooh, this is working nice and smoothly. But in the back end, there's, you know, 500,000 minions. Yeah, running around in their little with their little gears. Their glass. Yeah. So this would be one way. Another way would be that we have one hard drive here, another one here, another one here, and so we have all these hard drives where instead of putting all the information in one hard drive, we distribute the information across the hard drives, right? So that, let's say, if you have your resume and you go to save your resume, we're going, because you know what your computer does, right? What your computer does is it takes the information. When you press save on the information, it takes the information and it breaks it down into chunks, into fragments. You guys ever heard the term defragmentation? Uh-huh. That's because your computer breaks your resume down, right? So let's say if this is your resume right here, your computer goes, oh, okay, let me take your resume. Oh, you want to save it? Okay, no problem. Here, let me grab your resume. Okay, let me just fragment it into different fragments. And I'm going to save one of the fragments here, another one here, another one here, another one here, another one there, another one there. It's fragmented into pieces. It's all over the place. Okay, and so what we can do is we can save some of the fragments here, some of the fragments here, and some of the fragments here. You see that? Because your information, when you save your information, your computer takes your information, breaks it down into fragments, and then saves it in different locations, okay? And so by doing this, we are increasing the life expectancy of the hard drives because we're not allowing one single hard drive to do all the work. You see that? We are distributing the work across different hard drives, and so therefore, theoretically, we are increasing the life expectancy of the components. But now that doesn't mean they're not gonna fail. It's still, these devices are gonna fail. That's kind of the beauty of it. Because if you install them and they never fail, you'd be out of a job. There might be no point in doing this training, okay? We call this striping. Striping. We stripe like a zebra, okay? You put one here, one here, one here. There's another way in which we can do this. We can have 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 hard drives. And so these hard drives, it's the same principle, right? We're going to allow these hard drives to save the fragments in different hard drives like this. But one of these hard drives is going to be utilized for what we call parity. Wow, man, how do I remember all this stuff? You know, sometimes I'm sitting at home or I'm sitting in the backyard and I'm watching the stars and I'm like, I can't think of any of these concepts. I just can't. I'm like, man, I don't know how I'm gonna teach tomorrow. I'm just like, I don't even remember any of this. But when I'm here, it just kind of all comes back. All right, that was a little inside. I shouldn't have said that, but in any case. the word parity has to do with the ability to it's the ability to restore information in case of failure. Okay, and so what we do is this hard drive right here will be utilized to provide a value to the information in case one hard drive fails. Right? So let's say that I have fragment here, fragment here, fragment here, fragment here. Okay, this one is my parity hard drive, my fifth one. And so if that hard drive fails, so let's say that I have a 1 and a 1 and a 0 and a 1. Okay, if this number is missing, this one right here will try to restore the number that was missing. You see that? So this is what we call striping with parity. this by the way, this information I'm giving you here is not part of ITIL. I'm just illustrating. Okay? I'm just illustrating the concept of how we address fault tolerance. So if I have a customer that I really need to provide service to, I don't want my service desk to be unavailable, right? So if we need to provide 24/7 service to my to a specific customer, we might need to outsource because we may not have the manpower to provide technical support here in this geographical area, and so we outsource to India, right? So that we can, and we have to have systems in place so that we start the transition of the responsibilities, say at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and transition to India until 6:30, and then now they're operating over there. The customer won't even notice. Why have you been watching, man? I better check your web browsing history over there. So is that correct, striping?
Yes.
Okay. So what is fault tolerance is the ability for us to continue to provide the service, okay? So, and this is why when they're in the business case stage, right, of the creation of this new process, this is why they need to talk to the technical department. You see that? Because the person that's trying to champion this process may not have enough technical understanding to understand what components we need to have in place in order to provide fault tolerance and therefore increasing our availability in meeting our targets as far as service level agreement is concerned. You guys with me? Yeah, so all of that is not really important, but I just wanted to illustrate that how fault tolerance might look, okay? Continuous operation minimizes or masks the effects of plant downtime, okay? Continuous availability minimizes or masks the effects of IT component failure or plant downtime. This concept right here, the ARRMSS of availability, I'm gonna be asking you that. Just like we were talking about the other concepts, okay? What are the arms of availability? The arms of availability are: A is availability, reliability, resilience. What is resilience? What is resilience?
Being tough. Oh, wait a second. Availability is also, it is the time, it is also the name of the process, okay? The five arms of availability are availability. It is the time that a customer is able to access a particular service. Usually it's expressed as a percentage of uptime. And that percentage number is what? 99.99. Man, everybody, you gotta know this number. It's the five nines. What is reliability? It is the freedom from operational failure under specific conditions. Resilience is another measure of freedom of operational failure. Basically, it minimizes the consequences of component failure via redundancy, clustering, duplexing, and so on. So this is it, right?
This is clustering. I am creating clusters so that
I can address my fault tolerance. Resilience minimizes the consequence of component failure via redundancy, clustering, duplexing, and so on. Maintainability is making sure that we can restore in a satisfactory state. Serviceability is the ability of a third-party provider to meet contractual conditions. And then security. When we think about security, I want you to think of three letters. These three letters are CIA. CIA does not stand for the, what is CIA?
Central
Intelligence Agency. It's CIA stands for confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Okay? When I'm thinking about security, I'm thinking about three things. Confidentiality. How reliable is this service in regards to protecting my data, my information? That's confidentiality. Which means that only the people who have authorization to access the data should access the data. Integrity and availability. Integrity is the ability of a system to transfer data from one location to another without the data being tampered with. That's what integrity is. Did it hold its integrity? Can it hold its integrity? Can we transfer the information from one location to another and have the information be the exact same copy? And availability. Right, and when we think of availability, that is the 99.999%. This is what we call availability management. And all of the information for how to handle availability should be stored in our configuration management system. Okay? In a document called the availability management document. This is key right here, everybody. ARRMSS. What are the five ARRMSS? You're gonna get a question like, within the concept of availability, which of the following applies? And then you'll get a whole list of letters, or not letters, but words, and you have to remember, if you have ARRMSS, okay, reliance is one of them, or reliability is one of them, okay? Yes, sir, Anthony.
Yeah, I keep saying five. Okay, well, six.
Hey, I told you I'm not perfect, right? That 99.99%.
Yeah.
So, we got, you know, availability can be adjusted, right? Based on the need of the customer. Based on the promises that we made through the service level agreements. So do we want low availability, medium, or high? Well, if you want high availability, where's the Benjamin Franklins? Okay.
Capacity management ensures that the capacity and the performance of IT service components matches the current and future agreed needs of the customer and the business in the most effective and timely manner. Okay, important aspects of capacity is it produces and maintains capacity plan, provides advice to the business, so the capacity manager, and I'm missing a letter there too. I thought I fixed this last semester, I don't know. Maybe, I need to upload the updated copies. Huh? We are trying to ensure with capacity that we meet or exceed agreed targets. We're trying to assist with the resolution of related incidents. The purpose of capacity management is to ensure that cost-justifiable IT capacity in all areas is in place. Okay? Do I have enough people? When I'm thinking about capacity, I'm asking the following questions. Do I have enough people? Do I need more human resources? Do I need more skills? Do I need to grow my own? Or can I outsource? Do I have to outsource? Do I have the proper processes in place? Capacity, right? Capacity management. See how I'm addressing the four P's. When capacity, do I have the four P's? When I'm thinking of capacity, do I have enough suppliers to meet the demand? Okay, do I have enough product? So, which means technology. Do I have enough computer equipment, network equipment, in order to make this happen? That's what I'm thinking when I'm thinking about capacity, right? We're trying to ensure cost justifiable components. Oh boy. Oh boy, oh boy. So, again, you know, the individual who is proposing a business case will have to have a conversation with the capacity manager in order, and that information is to be included in the business case. Because we're not gonna try to figure out later down the road, right, what we really needed. Right here, what we're doing now here is actually implementing the concepts, right? Implementing what we budgeted for. And now we're designing it basically based on the dollar amounts that we got approved for. Capacity plan is the main output of here. Okay. Once the capacity plan is published, it needs to be updated constantly through the CSI process. Yes, sir.
So in your past experiences, have you seen all this coordination go on like it's supposed to?
Well, again, you know, it all comes down to dollars. All comes down to dollars. You know, I deployed a network for a testing center, and it required at least one computer server, and you know, but we were dealing with at least 60 client computers, one computer server, okay, and we had one T1 connection to the internet, and so, you know, when I made a proposal for us to move on to deployment of a testing center, I requested two servers, not just one, right? Because I'm trying to address fault tolerance and capacity. Let me see. So did I have enough hardware power to make it happen? Okay? And so if one server fails, I can go ahead and just deploy another one. It's already ready and reconfigured. I can get the system up and running in half hour, right? And then what I also recommended is that we get another connection, an additional connection, because according to my estimation, based on network bandwidth and speed, we didn't have enough bandwidth to support all the users that we could potentially have, you know, once the system was up and running. And so we ended up deploying a second server as a backup and getting another T1 connection. So we had two T1 connections. In case one failed, we could revert to the other connection, and that wouldn't cause, you know, too many problems to the users. Maybe a slowdown in bandwidth and connectivity. Maybe the users would experience a little bit of buffering time, but that's it. You know, they wouldn't really experience downtime. That's about all I got, Greg. Did you have a question or a comment? No? that was a long time ago? Okay, continuity management. What is the purpose of continuity management? Ensures the required IT technical and service facilities can be resumed within required and agreed business timescales. Important aspects of that is that we're trying to ensure the survival by reducing the impact of disaster or major failure. Oh, here you go. What is considered a disaster? That's a test question, believe it or not. A disaster could be a fiber line that has been cut in a metropolitan area. That's a disaster. An earthquake is a disaster. A flood is a disaster. A tornado is a disaster. Yeah, not natural disaster, okay? Hurricanes is a disaster. Tropical storms, disaster. Terrorist attack, disaster. And you know, it's happening a lot right now in England, you know? Sorry about that. I feel better though, man. I could go until 6 o'clock today. Believe it or not, this is a test question. You will get a question like this in the actual exam. Yeah, which of the following, what would be considered a natural disaster? Okay. Or a disaster. Fire is not in my list. Yeah, and I don't think you're going to see fire as an option anyways. No, well, it is. A terrorist attack is a national disaster. You don't, you know, with when 9/11 happened, it's a national disaster.
Oh, I thought you
said natural. A natural disaster. No, no, it's just called a disaster. We refer to them as disasters. Yeah. What is considered a disaster? Where I suppose a fire would be considered a disaster. I don't remember. Yeah. I don't remember seeing fire as an option ever in the exams or quizzes for ITIL. But tornadoes, yeah, for sure. And floods. A what? A civil war? War, huh? A disaster. Yes, disastrous. Yeah, displacement, huh? What'd you say? He said that when he drops his hump, his burger is considered a disaster. They canceled the bachelorette program. It's a disaster.
It's back on.
Yeah, it's back on. You might not be able to ensure the continuity of the service if what? That's right, and that's why I don't have just one supplier, right? I have multiple suppliers because I don't want to be stuck having to deal with, you know, the fact that they didn't have a continuity plan, and so now I'm stuck with. So that may be an issue that we need to address when we become partners, before I make that individual company my supplier. Is I'm going to have to address, hey, what's your continuity plan? What are you going to do if there's a terrorist attack or, you know, there's a flood? How are you going to, what are you promising me? Right, these are the questions that you're asking before we move forward with creating a partnership. Because I don't want to create a partnership with an entity that's gonna set me up for failure, okay?
How about like Ebola or something like that? Would that be considered a disaster?
Like an outbreak of disease?
Yes.
Hey man, that can affect my human resources. It could bring down my human resources.
Oh, yeah. You would have nothing.
That's a problem. The people aspect of the four P's, Gregory. What's that? No, no what, Bill? No team buildings? We're not gonna pay you to go to vacation, huh, in Africa.
That's where Simone is at right now. Yeah, we're team building in Las Vegas, huh?
All right, key concepts for continuity. We're trying to continuity management. What is the, we need to consider what is the impact to the business? Is there any service loss, financial impact, and then if there is a financial impact, to what degree? The morale impact, so human resources, right, the people. The health and safety, the physical protection of the employees. Another thing that can affect continuity is bad news in the front of the newspaper, business news, for example. These items will help quantify the impact of the loss. Do your planning around two pieces, those pieces that may hurt your organization move forward. All right, things that you need to consider. What is the damage? What is the financial damage? Reputation damage. It's a to what degree? It's a personal harm. It's a minimal pain. It's a catastrophic. Did this hurt our reputation? You know, gossip can hurt business. Right. That's why you need to conduct a business an impact analysis. Right. That's basically what we're trying to do. You need to have an impact analysis in place so that you understand what would happen if and what actions to take. Different companies may use different threat analysis processes based on what infrastructure they may have implemented. Okay? So, you know, we're gonna have to create a risk plan, you know, identify what the hazards are, evaluate, review, control. If I put a plan in place for continuity and I never test it, is that a smart move?
No.
Oh, you wanna test it. That's like having a fire, you know, escape program and never testing it, right? Mm-hmm. Or an earthquake, you know, response plan, but we never test it. You need to test it, right? And so that could be a tricky endeavor, right? Because, you know, people are going to have resistance to that, but you're going to have to get a buy-in. And then we have the security.
I said not the other process, right, for service design. Information security is the process that aligns IT security with business security and ensures that the information security is effectively managed in all service and service management activities. We are trying to cover the confidentiality. What is confidentiality? Ensures that data is accurate and protected from unauthorized access. Only the people with enough authorization should have access to certain aspects of the database or physical location, right? It's not just the protecting the data and the computers and the network.
by installing intrusion detection or intrusion prevention systems, but also or firewalls and configuring networks so that they prioritize and apply quality of service or closing some of the ports or disallowing some of the protocols, but also physical location, right? Physical location, there's many ways in which people can, you know, there was a trend going on a couple of years ago, about three years ago, where people would walk into office environments and just go into cubicles and steal purses and stuff, right? And steal wallets and laptops and so on and so forth. This was in the news. It happened to us here in Oakland when I was working in Oakland. When we went out to lunch, somebody walked in to the office. There was nobody in the front desk at the moment, and they went in and they stole one of my colleagues' laptops, and then stole one of my colleagues' another colleague's purse. Yeah, and gone, disappeared, right? And so you need to secure the physical locations by installing proper deterrence, right? Maybe installing biometric devices. Maybe putting cameras in place, right? Train people. You have to train people how to listen. You can put all the systems in place that you want, but you know what? The weakest part of the network is what? The people. Because we are such nice folks here in the US, right? Check it out. If I'm about to go into a building and somebody else is coming, we go like this. We go, sure, come again. I'll hold the door for you. We don't even know who the person is.
You are laughing, but that's exactly something that happened to me. We were in class, and we generally know each other, so we leave our recess and
that happens. And there's actually a technical term for that. I think it's piggybacking. Yeah. So we're also trying to ensure the integrity of the data, right? That if we transfer from one location to another, that it holds its integrity. We're trying to ensure availability. So the information security manager is working with the availability manager to make sure that we have everything up and running. Key concepts of information security: must have full support from top management, which includes information security policy, use and misuse of IT assets, access password controls, policies for email, internet use, supplier access, asset disposal, right? We're gonna have to outline a policy for the use of the equipment, okay? Creation of passwords. Your password cannot be password. It cannot be, the password cannot be God or dog or shoe. Simple words, cannot be simple words, right? Because you know what? This is why, man, if you just go take that ethical hacking class, I tell you, you know, we could deploy a dictionary attack, basically go an attack that goes through all the words in a dictionary to try to figure out what your password is. Words in the dictionary and combinations of numbers, right? And that's why you have to have upper letters, lowercase letters, non-alphanumeric characters, right? Such as ampersand, dollar sign, pound sign, star, or and so on and so forth, right? We also need to make sure that We have a policy for email. You know, right now there's a lot of phishing going on, right? So they basically get emails that says that the king of Nigeria is giving you $15 million, okay? And you have to respond to their email and do this and do that and do that. It's a very elaborate scheme, it really is. But you know what they do is that if they can figure out, if I can figure out what your account number is, bank account number, or if I can figure out the bank account numbers and logins and passwords of 500 people, and I take $4.99 out of each account every month, how much is that? Like $2,500, maybe? $25,000? I don't know. It's a large amount. I'm taking $5 out of 500 people. How much is that? $2,500 a month. Now, if I'm living in Nigeria and I'm getting $2,500 a month free of tax, I could live like a king. I just go to a Latin country, right? Buy me a rancho. I have 5 slides. If we finish them today, I'll let you go at 1:30 tomorrow. Get out of here then.
Can we negotiate?
Yeah, I told you, man.